Yeah, my name's Geraint, and you might guess that I'm from Wales. A lot of people have a bit of a problem with my name, but do bear with me. It's, there's a lot more little Geraints about nowadays than when I was born. I'm going to talk quite generally about the biofuels landscape, and I'm going to focus a lot on the UK, really, rather than Europe, because that's where we do a lot of our work. But before we start, I just want to think, first of all, about the bio landscape. It's pretty complex, and it causes a lot of confusion and a lot of uncertainties. Is my mic working? Yeah, okay, thanks. If you look at that chart, my model of the UK energy industry, it's pretty horizontal in terms of its flows. North Sea gas provides our most of our heat. Something like 85, 86% of houses are connected to the gas grid. Oil provides our transport, coal, nuclear, gas provide our power. And agriculture has gas going into it for fertilizer and diesel for tractors, for example. But there's very little integration across those horizontal flows there. And we see that also in government departments. And I'd like to, you know, I'd like them to work more closely together to help us with biofuels. Because as you go into the bio landscape and introduce perhaps biorefineries in the future, it gets really complicated. There's no, you know, no worries about where all these lines are going, but you can see that bio hits heat, power, transport, and chemicals. And there's also this recycle loop into agriculture. So you think about the DDGS from AD, it goes back into agriculture. Sorry, DDGS from ethanol production goes back into agriculture, and digestate from AD as well. So it's complex. So I'm going to start in a moment with a bit of context with the UK fuels industry, moving on to why we want to use biofuels. Then we'll look at how we're going to meet some targets we've got coming up in 8 years' time, which is actually quite close, and think about the constraints we have on the biofuels we have today and what else we can do to make biofuels from different resources. And I'll finish with my thought about what the roadmap might be to develop biofuels in the UK, because unfortunately it's not a very easy place to work and to invest in at this present time, is biofuels. It's a bit of a black story. So let's start with the fuels industry in the UK. It's a huge industry. We use about 40 million tonnes of diesel and petrol a year. We've got 7 refineries. In the very recent past there were 9, and they provide over half of our petrol and diesel. We use a heck of a lot more diesel than we do petrol, and the use of diesel is growing quite strongly, as is the use of jet fuel, which is kind of a cousin in quality to diesel. Jet fuel is growing at 4% a year, and we import about 50%. Our capability to make mid-distillate fuels is quite constrained. We're kind of sort of just in balance in the UK, but Europe is short of production capacity, because when we built our refineries, we designed them to make petrol. And so as a result, we're long on petrol, we're short on diesel. So if you're going to make biofuels, you might think it's an easier sell to put biodiesel into the diesel pool than it is to put bioethanol into the petrol pool. I had an important point to just make there. I'll probably come back to it. Oh, yes. Demand on diesel is going to get tighter and tighter with new rules. The rail industry uses about 1 million tonnes of gas oil a year, and it from 2015 is going to need to use low sulphur diesel, so that's going to tighten up the market. As is the shipping industry. Certain areas in the sea around the channel also going to have to move to low sulphur diesel so they'll tighten up on diesel demand as well. So I think actually the differential between petrol and diesel can only get bigger in the future. So I'm looking at a petrol car next time I think I look to change. So it's a huge market, and we also got to just finally think of the size of refineries. We've got 6, 7 of them. They're about 250,000 barrels a day. It's not world scale, it's a little bit smaller than that. When we think of biorefineries, they're about 5,000 barrels a day on a world scale, so there's a scale mismatch, and that causes issues and economic cost issues, because the bigger the scale, the cheaper your fuel. So bio probably always be quite expensive compared to fossil. So why do we use biofuels? Well, the main reason in Europe is that we want to do some decarbonisation of the transport fuel pool. Transport's quite interesting because the cars move around, so and they like to have a high energy dense liquid fuel. So it's actually quite difficult to decarbonise them. You can't capture the CO2. The second reason is an energy security reason. You know, we all know that oil is a limited resource. It's going to run out. People reckon around 50 years' time it's going to start getting quite difficult to use. So we want to think of alternative renewable resources. And finally, building the agricultural economy. We want to think about making agriculture more economic. Those are macro reasons. The main reason that we actually do use biofuels is because we're mandated to do so by the road transport fuels obligation. Road transport, it's not aviation, it's not rail, it's road transport. So the government tells us we must include biodiesel and or bioethanol in our transport fuels, and it's rising in inclusion rate up to 5% by 2014. That's 5% by volume. Because as we go to 2020, we have a new regulation coming in from Europe that says 15% of our energy has got to come from renewable resources, with a sub-target for transport of 10% of the energy. So 5% by volume has got to go up to 10% by energy. Now, 10% by energy of ethanol and petrol is about 14% by volume. So it's quite a jump. And at the moment, I don't believe there's a trajectory from government telling us how to get from that 5% to the 10% by energy, and also beyond 2020. So there's a market availability issue there, a design issue for people looking to invest in biofuels. That's for Europe. Decarbonisation is important, but for other parts of the world, there are other drivers. The US, it's all about energy security. So they look at alternative fuels as opposed to renewable fuels. Brazil is into exports. It's into agricultural economics. So it depends on which, you know, where you are in the world, depends on the drivers that you're going to use. So what can we do today? Well, we have what we call first generation biofuels. And it's basically taking vegetable oil or sugars and turning them into a fuel. Now, in general principle, anything from a vegetable oil goes into the diesel, and anything made from a sugar goes into the petrol. The vegetable oil is actually quite hard won in nature, and that's probably one of the reasons why you hear a lot about people complaining about biodiesel not being very sustainable and very difficult. They make a quick calculation and say, well, we need 25 odd million tons of biodiesel to replace all our diesel. That would need twice the UK land area. But that's just a silly calculation to do. You have to realise that thinking about biofuels is a layered approach to decarbonise transport that we must think about. Our opinion is that first generation biofuels can at least probably deliver that 10% target. It's perhaps a bit tight, but probably. Biodiesel or FAME is made from vegetable oil like rape oil, the yellow fields that we see down the east coast of down the east of the UK. That's the grain belt in the UK. And we grow it in rotation with wheat. So a field will grow wheat for 2 years, but after 2 years, the yields go down, so we must put in a break crop. And so we have to grow rape to make that break, to kill all the bugs, to get rid of the diseases. We take the vegetable oil, which you can burn in a diesel engine, but we mix it with methanol in a catalyst. That takes the gloopiness out of the vegetable oil, yielding glycerol, which we sell out somewhere else for chemicals, and it leaves us with an ester, which we can use as a substitute for diesel. You can't use it as a light-for-light replacement, generally, because of the high-speed diesel engines we use nowadays, but it does replace quite well. Not only can we do that methanol synthesis, that methanol reaction, there's a new process now where we treat vegetable oil with hydrogen, and that makes a pure synthetic diesel or a pure synthetic biojet. Remember, jet fuel and diesel are cousins, and there's a factory in Rotterdam by a company called Neste Oil, a million tons a year, that makes synthetic diesel and probably synthetic jet fuel. Most of the biofuel flights you'll have seen will have been fueled with fuel made from vegetable oil. You'll see in a moment that most of our vegetable oil derived fuels are made from used cooking oil rather than rape oil. The other side of it is if I want to make a petrol, something to put in petrol, we think about using ethanol. And we do that, we make it from sugars, sugar cane, sugars derived from starch like corn or wheat, or sugars derived from the really complex polymeric sugars that's within all biomass, like straw. Okay. And what we do is we take that sugar and we ferment the sugar up with yeast and make a beer. We distill it till it's about 99.999% pure, because if it's got any water in it, when you mix it with petrol, it separates out in the fuel tank. So the ethanol's got to be really, really dry. We can also think about making butanol. You'll have heard BP talking about this. It's a slightly more energy-dense fuel and has some advantages with respect to meeting the policy targets. Ethanol's interesting. It's a really good fuel. It's just not what we're used to using as a fuel, so we're not set up to use it. It actually has some really strong benefits. It has a high octane rating, so it allows you to use your engine more efficiently. It cools when it evaporates. You know, when you have alcohol in your hand, it cools your hand. It evaporates quicker than petrol, so you get more of an energy charge into your engine. So it's actually a really good fuel. Like I say, it's just not what we're used to. Bit of a story of where we are with how much we're using under the RTFO, Road Transport Fuels Obligation. These are year two, year three, year four of the obligation. Year four is where we are now. And early on, we were using about 70% biodiesel, as you might imagine. We are tight on biodiesel supply, but I expect it's because of costs of ethanol decreasing that we're using more and more ethanol. Looking more closely at ethanol, it's a story of subsidy, really. When we started off in the early years, we were using a lot of ethanol that came from Brazil. That's dropped off quite sharply. There's the Brazilian ethanol, and I think it's there, that one there, the Brazilian ethanol. Brazil's had some issues with supply, and so that's kind of dropped off. But the really interesting thing is the increase in corn ethanol, and we're using a lot of corn ethanol now, and that's probably due to Sam, and Dave can probably help me if I get this wrong on the panel. It's probably because of the subsidy regime, because we're importing corn ethanol as a chemical and it gets a different tariff, so it's making it cheaper. Unfortunately, the guys in the US I saw this morning on a report are making ethanol at a bit of a loss at the moment. They're making about 12 cent a gallon, US gallon loss at the moment, so it's not a great business to be in. Biodiesel, again, a story of subsidy. Early years, quite a mix of fuels, a lot of soy biodiesel. There was a thing called Splash and Dash where the Argentinians were taking their soy oil, making it into biodiesel, taking the subsidy there, I think, dropping it, exporting it to the US, taking the subsidy there, it was a dollar a gallon, exporting it into the UK, taking the subsidy here, and landing it in, selling it cheaper than we could make it here. So soy was a good example of a subsidy. It's dropped off now because we're using a lot more used cooking oil. Government sees it as more sustainable, and so they subsidize it more heavily than any other type of biodiesel, to the point now that we're using a heck of a lot of used cooking oil to make biodiesel. It's, I think we're using about 4 million tons or something greater than I thought would be available. So the economics of making biodiesel aren't too great. People are focusing on used cooking oil because it comes with a gate fee or it comes free. Rape oil is generally at the price of diesel or a bit higher, so the margin for making biodiesel from rape is not so good. And you'll find that in UK especially, the people who've got biodiesel factories have got what they do is they take used cooking oil, and if they run out of that, they probably loaf their factories. Cargill have just announced that they're closing a factory in Germany that was focused on using rape making rape oil into biodiesel. and they're loafing a second one. So the economics are not easy. And to top it all, the EU just brought this out. It's a proposal from the 17th of October to try and control what we call the indirect effects of growing crops to make fuel, because people think that it's going to cause deforestation, which is a risk, and it must be looked at and carefully analysed. But it puts a cap on how many biofuels we can use to 5%, half the target. And so that's damaging people's thoughts about where the market might be. So let's just summarise that bit. I do think that first-generation biofuels have got a place. I think they could probably get to about 10% of our fuel supply, but there's more potential to expand the production of first-generation bioethanol than first-generation biodiesel. But it's in the diesel sector where there's all the growth, so there's a bit of a mismatch there. Now, we could get people to use more petrol cars, but I don't see any desire from government to drive that. Petrol is actually cleaner burning than diesel, so I think that would be a good thing personally, but I don't see any drive for that. Or perhaps we could think about alternatives to making biodiesels in different ways. So let's look at that. So if we're thinking about alternative ways of making biofuels away from using vegetable oils, away from using food crops, we've got to think of all the other types of materials that we grow that are renewable. This chart, the three bars there, is a desk study on how much biomass have people reported that there is to access in the UK. The left bar is the maximum numbers that we found, and the right bar, the minimum numbers that we found. And the middle is what kind of we thought. But the main thing that you get from that is that we don't actually know how much biomass we've actually got. The second takeaway point, more seriously, is that the biggest resource we've got is waste, and that processes really need to be feedstock flexible. Yeah, they might, especially in the future, they might try and use waste as a maximum, but they've got to think, well, if there's some straw available or if some miscanthus available, they've got to use that. So feedstock flexibility is important. The next thing to think about, I've thought about my resources, I need feedstock flexibility perhaps, is what technologies have I got available? And this is a list of all the technologies that I can think of. If you go away from here and think, there's just two basic classifications of these new technologies. There's the ones that use biology, which I call biochemical, and they try to access the sugars that's in biomass. And there's the ones called thermochemical, where we use heat and catalytic chemical processes to access the elemental carbon and hydrogen. Okay. So all of these, they fall into one of those, except for that one, which is a hybrid. Okay. So lignocellulosic ethanol is what the US is doing, and they're taking corn stover and they're attacking it with enzymes and they're finding sugars and they're fermenting those sugars up into ethanol. You see a lot of reports of that. In the red, I've estimated that its commercialization or development is ongoing somewhere in the world. In the yellow, commercialization is going on somewhere. And in the green, I think, well, this could probably happen in the UK. Somebody could start building a commercial plant, perhaps a bit small. But you can see that I don't think it's going to happen in the UK because this kind of process likes to have one feedstock, corn stover or straw. I don't think there's enough of any one kind of biomass, so I'm not so sure that this will deploy strongly before 2020. Gasification-derived biofuels. This is the one that uses the elements. This is where, I'll show you a chart in a moment, where we use gasification to access the carbon and hydrogen. Once we've got the source of carbon and hydrogen, we can build those back up into molecules, fuel molecules. British Airways are building a plant here in London to make jet fuel from waste. How successful they'll be, I don't know, but it's due to be opened in 2015. There's stuff happening, deployment happening now, and commercialization might be happening around 2013, 2014. Most exciting, perhaps, is syngas fermentation. Here we use gasification. commercialization is happening right now. There's a plant in Florida by Ineos Bio that is being commissioned right now this quarter, and it should be producing ethanol before the end of the year. And what we do here is we take carbon monoxide and ferment it into ethanol. There's another company called LanzaTech who are working with Nottingham University. They're deploying projects out in China. And therein's a story, because what China's doing and what the US is doing to support these plants is actually really good. It's working. It's working a lot stronger than it's happening here. This is a process diagram of that thermochemical process. We use a gasifier. This is the type being used by Air Products, or being developed by Air Products in Teesside. It's just a combustion process that doesn't use enough air, and it makes carbon monoxide and hydrogen. I've got to clean it up when I've made that gas. It's called syngas. And then, because it's carbon monoxide and hydrogen, I can burn it in a steam boiler and make some power. If I clean up the syngas some more, I can put it in an engine or a gas turbine. That's about an order of magnitude cleaner. And then an order of magnitude again, I can think about catalytic upgrading or fermentation of that syngas to make fuels. And there's a wide variety of things I can make. Jet fuel, chemicals, fertilizer, ethanol, all sorts of things. If I just say that BP at Hull, where I live, use syngas made from natural gas to make all the chemicals that we use that BP make. It's a standard gas. Unfortunately, this kind of system is quite risky to invest in. It's not well proven, particularly the integration of the whole caboodle, the whole lot. DFT have got a target to hit by 2020. We suggested a couple of years ago that they could possibly install some plants. And this is the modest scenario we came up with. Unfortunately, it's looking rather quite hard now, because it takes 4 or 5 years to develop a plant when things are good. And when you're developing a new technology like this, it's quite good. So I worry that DFT are not going to meet their targets now. They're looking at this cap of 5% on first-generation biofuels. Having said that, we told them, or did some calculations with Deloitte, that actually it's worth their time, their effort, to invest in these technologies. In terms of IP, in terms of job creation, in terms of decarbonisation, it should have a positive net present value. We think it's a good thing to do. But there is some lethargy, and I think policy inaction could be a derailer. I mentioned British Airways. They really want to develop jet fuel made from waste, made from biomass. They're developing a plant. But DFT don't support them. They support them with words, but they don't support them with the RTFO, the Road Transport Fuels Obligation. So this chart is just an indication of the revenues for burning syngas in various options. So if I use gasification and make a burnable syngas, I can just burn it. Sorry, if I take biomass and just burn it, I get that amount of revenue from various things. If I gasify it and put it in a gas engine, I get a bit more money. If it's the most efficient type of thing, I get more again. If I make it into road transport fuel, now this was at 22 pence a certificate. The certificates are actually half that now. So that red line should actually be about there. I get more. But if I want to make aviation fuel, from 2013 I might get some EU ETS payments. But if the process can make road transport fuel, why wouldn't I do that? Or even easier and less risky, if I can make power, why wouldn't I do that? So why would I invest in that? You know, policy in action. Policy is needed, support is needed to drive and help those people who really want to do this. This is kind of it's perhaps a bit complicated map of how I see biofuels developing, because I worry that there's not enough support for these advanced biofuels in the UK. So I work with the renewables obligation making electricity and see that people are deploying gasification projects, burning syngas with steam. I see people are doing more complicated things with gasification and burning syngas in engines. And that people like Advanced Plasma Power are looking to make natural gas from wastes, that British Airways are looking to make jet fuel. And I see these all developing into a kind of cloud where we get yield job creation, IP, R&D opportunities, etc. Key worry I have is always on the feedstock. We don't seem to be driving the growth of energy crops, afforestation. You know, if you put value into biomass, people will think, ah, I might plant a woodland and sustainably manage that to make wood chips. That is not happening. I think work is needed there. So I hope I've not gone over, but just to finish, like I say, these, you know, we're making first generation biofuels now. We can make them. They have a place in a kind of layered approach to decarbonising transport. If we want to use non-land-using biofuels, turning waste into fuels like jet fuel, we can do it. It's riskier. But we need more support, I don't know, in various ways, not just money, to support those. So, not including money, we need support timeframes beyond 2020. You need targets. You need a consistent market. You need a trajectory to get from 2014. We've got no trajectory in targets from 2014 to 2020. So how do you know whether you can sell your fuels? Guaranteed financial mechanism. That 5% cap comes with a recommendation that we're going to count biofuels made from waste, solid waste, four times. We don't know the value of that, so you can't bank it. So a clear strategy and delivery plan is needed. With that, thank you very much. I hope I haven't gone over.